But I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to pray. So I'm going to ask you, since we really need God today, let's get old school. And would you stand with me today, all right? Father, we come before you, Lord, and we're just grateful for the opportunity, Lord. We're grateful that we get to come into your house, Lord. We don't come into this place to hear from you, We don't come into this place to hear from me. Lord, help me. We don't come into this place to hear from a man, from a woman, Lord. We come to hear from you. God, we acknowledge that it's Jesus that's our senior leader. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would speak to us, would lead us, would guide us. Father, I pray as we get into your word, Lord, I pray that it's your word that makes an impact, because clearly my words can't. So, Father, we ask that you would speak to us tonight. Holy Spirit, have your way to move on your people. Lord, I pray that your presence would be in this room as we magnify and we lift up Jesus in this house. God, it's all about Jesus. If we came for any other reason, Lord, forgive us, because we come for Jesus. And Lord, we ask that you would bless this house. Bless our brothers and sisters across the Inland Empire today that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Bless our brothers and sisters across the world that are preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and being persecuted and are suffering for the sake of Jesus. Lord, I pray that your hand would be upon them to deliver them and to guide them and to lead them. And Lord, we ask that same prayer upon us, to lead us, to guide us, and to deliver us today, as we go before you and we expect to hear your word and to be changed by your word. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. 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 Well, if you have your Bibles, I pray you do, go with me to the book of Psalms 23. Psalms 23. Tonight, I have a word, and the word is, I want to talk to you. The title is, Pastor David kind of preached a little bit of my message. It's good. The Holy Spirit works that way. Today, I want to talk to you about going to the other side. Now, I don't want them to be mistaken. I didn't realize this until after I'd sent my notes out. I don't want them to be mistaken with Sunday night's message called Going the Distance, all right? I'm all about going lately, okay? Coming, going. Going to the other side. Today, I want to talk to you about that. I want to tell you a little story. You know, my family, we always vacation somewhere as a family. The whole Cobra/Roth Cobra clan, they ought to hyphenate that. The Cobra Roth clan, we all vacation together during the summer months. And a couple of years ago, we were up in Mammoth. I've talked about it a couple times before. I really like to fly fish. And I remember it was the time where, you know, I'd bought my dad some fly fishing stuff, Pastor Jim. And so he had a fly fishing setup. And I had a bunch of rods, because you can never have enough fishing rods. And I remember there was the kind of came up like, hey, why don't we all try to go fly fishing? So we took like the whole family. I remember I took Pastor Dan and we took all of the kids and dad took the kids. And we went up to this place. I said, man, it's hot. Every time I go here, I always catch fish, because I wanted, you know, one thing when you take a little kid fishing is it doesn't matter about how big of a fish they catch. It's just about, like, just catch a fish, and they'll be super happy about that, because otherwise, like, they'll never want to go again. So I was like, I've always caught fish up here. It's really high in the mountains. You drive up into the mountains. You go to about 10,000 feet is where the road ends, and then you walk a little ways to this little lake. Nobody's there. It's really beautiful scenery up in the high Sierras. Just gorgeous, gorgeous lake. And so we were up there. I was kind of giving everybody the rundown on what you got to do to fly fish, because I don't like the other type of fishing, because it's smelly and the bait stinks and all that. So fly fishing. So I taught everybody how to do the fly fishing thing. And so my dad says, okay, here's the plan. I'm going to take the kids with me. And I told Dan, Pastor Dan was with me. I said, okay, we're going to go on an adventure, man. I'm going to take you to the stream over here, because stream fishing is like the pinnacle, man. You got to fight the fish. You got to fight the current. You can't get it snagged in a rock. And so we were out there. I'm teaching Pastor Dan what you got to do and how to cast it and put the fly right here. And there's got to be a fish right there. It's just nothing. Nothing. It's dead. No life. And I'm like, man, I'm just totally, you know, just eating my words on this. So there we are, we're kind of talking about it, we're examining it, and we just keep hearing this little like, woohoo, woohoo, hooting and hollering, woohoo, woohoo, and we're like, what is that? And my dad, he didn't want to walk the distance it was to walk the stream, so he was like, I'm going to take the easy path on this lake, and I'm going to take the little kids, and we're just going to go to the other side of the lake. And so there, Dan and I, we were out there, and we were in this spot where it should have been good fishing, and there was nothing happening, and we're looking across this big lake, and on the other side of the lake, everything was going down. Everybody was catching fish. It didn't matter how old you are, it didn't matter how terrible of a fisherman you were, everybody was catching fish. And it seems like, you know, we were on the wrong side of the lake. And it was a journey. We had to walk all the way up and around because we had missed the trail, and we had to cross over the river, get our feet wet, and walk through a marsh just to get to the side where everybody else was fishing so we could get a piece of that action. But in that story, sometimes I think life kind of seems like that. Like we're on the other side. It seems like everybody else is doing well. The economy, you read the reports of the economy, it's picking up, and then yet you're kind of like, wait, I haven't got that job I've been waiting for. I mean, I understand everything went down and my life changed and I made the adjustments, but now everything's picking up, and why haven't I got that job back? Or maybe you're looking at everybody else's kids. I know this with my kids. It's like everybody else's kids are progressing and they're doing really well, and it's like, man, everything is going so good on the other side of the lake. Why is it that's on my side, things aren't progressing? Maybe people around you are doing well, or you're seeing God's blessing them, or God's speaking to them, or they're getting that fulfillment of their happiness, and they're smiling again when it seems like, I just can't seem to get out of the rain in my life. Everything is always happening on the other side. Has anybody ever felt that way in life? Anybody ever felt that way about your job, about somebody around you? It just seems like, you know, we even have a statement that we say all the time. If I say it, you'll know it. We always say it like this. We say that the grass is greener on the other side, right? And that was really a statement designed kind of to teach us the appreciation for what we have. You know, kind of just value what you have, because the grass will always be greener on the other side. I remember one time I preached a message about the grass being greener on the other side, and I see my neighbor, his grass is literally always greener, but you pay the service and I don't. Amen. So sometimes it can seem like, you know, things are always happening and we're always on the wrong side of it happening. I know that's just how it always seems to go in my life. But I want to tell you something today. I believe with all of my heart that God wants to take you to the other side. I believe that where you're at, Pastor David was talking about this today, that where you're at is not where God wants you to be. Why? Because God wants to take you to the other side. He wants to take you somewhere else. He wants to take you to a higher place in life. And when you get there, guess what? God wants to take you to the other side again. Because God always wants to continually bless you, to continually do something in your life. Why? God wants to give you the desires of your hearts, because that's the desire of God's heart. I'd have you turn to Psalms, the 23rd chapter. Psalms 23rd chapter, man, it's like the famous psalm. We know this. It's David's psalm, and we could quote it. It's like they always quote it at a funeral. But either way, Psalms chapter 23, verse number 1, David says that the Lord is my shepherd, and he says, I shall not want. Now, sometimes we read that, we see like, he's the shepherd I don't want. No, he's not saying that, okay? He's saying the Lord is my shepherd, and because the Lord is my shepherd, I don't have any wants. I don't have any needs. I got everything taken care of. David's saying, man, God, you got it all in control, and I am sitting here happy underneath you. He says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Verse number 2, look what he says. He says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. See, the other side, the grass is greener on the other side. The psalmist David says in this psalm, he says, God makes me. He says, hey, I want you to lay down here. It's green. And he leads me besides still waters. I really like the image that David is painting here. He's saying, God, he is my shepherd. And not only is God is my shepherd that he takes me to all the best grazing grounds. He doesn't take me to the field that's full of thorns and thistles that I got to weed out. He leads me beside green fields. He wants me to go to that place on the other side. He takes me to the best watering holes, where the water is clear, where the water is clean, where the water is cold, and the water is refreshing. God wants you to go to the other side. It's his desire for you. To take you to another level, to take you higher in life. He doesn't want you to remain the way you are. Why? Because you are a living, breathing, walking testimony of God's goodness. And so when you succeed in life, guess what? God succeeds. Why? Because people see you, like the Bible says, and they glorify God because something is happening in your life. And man, people begin to look at you and they say, I don't know what's going on, but the grass is always green on your side. Because God wants to take you to the other side. And I think sometimes we need to understand that. Sometimes we need to realize that because, you know, troubles, hardships, when you look at life around you, when you look at what people are going through, when you look at things that are happening in your own life, sometimes it just seems like, man, nothing's happening. And maybe this is just, I talked about it on Sunday, maybe this is just my cross to carry. But I believe God wants to do some great things in your life. And there are many of you in this place today that maybe you feel today that God doesn't want to take you somewhere. That God, that maybe he's left you out, or maybe the bus has left and everybody around you has been elevated, or everybody around you, you've seen the maturity and the growth in their life, but you're kind of wondering, when is my chance? Well, I want to tell you today, God wants to take you to the other side. And we're going to look at that. We're going to look at the, some things in the Bible. And, you know, the Bible's full of great stories, man. I love the stories of the Bible. Particularly, I think the greatest story of the Bible is the story of Jesus Christ. Why? Because it encompasses Genesis all the way through Revelation. He's in everything. Pastor Dan had that one really cool Pentecostal moment where everybody got a little crazy waving their hankies about Jesus in the Bible. But I think aside from that, one of the greatest stories in the Bible is a story that we know as the Exodus, or the departure from Egypt into the Promised Land and taking the Promised Land. Now, it's kind of funny because there was a movie that came out. I saw the movie recently and I'm like, dang, Hollywood got it so wrong. Like, okay, all right, you know, that's their interpretation. Today, I want to take a look at the story of the Exodus, the story of the Hebrew people leaving Egypt and inheriting the Promised Land, and just take you through some of the chapters in the Bible just quickly as we can look at some principles or some things that God, I believe, wants to speak into your life, to speak to you today about your journey to the other side, of taking you to that next level, taking you to that next level in life. And today I want to look at that story of the book, or of the story of the Exodus in the Bible. So if you got your Bibles, go with me. We're going to go through a couple of chapters, but go with me to the book of Exodus first in the sixth chapter. Exodus in the sixth chapter, God wants to take you to the other side. And we're going to look at God taking this group of people, his chosen people, literally to the other side of where they were, from slavery, from bondage, to freedom, and a place to call their own, the Promised Land. And we're going to look at this journey, and just look at some of the things that happened along the way, and things that we can apply as God is taking us to the other side. So here in the book of Exodus, in the sixth chapter, God is speaking to Moses. And so what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to kind of tell the story. As I tell the story, we'll jump into scripture. We'll see the scriptural aspect of it. Then we'll kind of jump back into the story and we'll just tell the story. And then we'll kind of come back and look at what the scripture says about the certain thing, because there's way too many things to pull out of this message tonight. And we got to kind of keep that for time's sake. So in Exodus, the sixth chapter, God is speaking to Moses and God is directing Moses. Now the story goes, if you've seen Exodus, Gods and Kings. Well, maybe I'll throw some of that in there. If you didn't, that way, if you've seen it, you're like, I thought that's how it went. We'll talk about that. Moses was a Hebrew boy born. Pharaoh decreed the people of the Hebrews were growing too much in population. They were afraid that they were going to overtake Egypt. So Pharaoh later decreed that everybody under the age of 2 was to be killed. Moses was a baby boy. His mom decided not to kill him. They put him in a basket, covered it with tar, floated it down the river. Pharaoh's daughter was there bathing. She found the basket. She raised Moses as her own. Moses was about 40 years old, walking around, saw some injustices done to the Hebrews. He killed an Egyptian guard. There he ran to the wilderness, and he came back after 40 years in the wilderness after God had spoken to him to come and to redeem his people from slavery. So God is speaking to Moses after God is commissioning Moses in Exodus in the sixth chapter, beginning in verse number 5. I want to just point this out. Exodus in the sixth chapter, beginning in verse number 5, God is speaking to Moses, and God says to Moses, I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. And I have, listen to this, remembered my covenant. Very important. If you got a pen, if you got a Bible that you want to write in or mark in, you really ought to underline those words. God says, I have remembered my covenant. Verse number 6, he goes on and he says, therefore, say to the children, God is telling Moses to say these things, say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. And I love this, that covenant. Here he is. And I will bring you into the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I will give it to you as a heritage. I am the Lord. So God is instructing Moses what to say. Now, coincidentally, Moses goes and tells the people they don't believe him. And that's a different story. Well, it's not a different story. It's the same story. But what God is saying here in this story, so often what happens when you look at something else and when you feel like you're on the other side of something happening, when everything else is progressing around you, when everybody else is getting blessed around you, when things seem to be moving and you seem to be stuck, It seems and it becomes really easy to begin to feel like God has forgotten. But today, in your journey of God wanting to take you to the other side, I want to tell you, and the word is, God has not forgotten you. God has not forgotten you. Now, for over 400 years, the Hebrews cried out to God for deliverance. For over 400 years, they prayed and they were on their knees and they were subject to Egypt's slavery. But 400 years later, when God saw that the timing was perfect, when everybody was there, when Moses was there, when Aaron was there, when Joshua was alive, and when Caleb was alive, God says, this is the time, and now it's time for me to take you to the other side. It gets so easy when everything else is happening around to think, God, you forgot me. God, you're not listening. God, you don't care. Everybody else is praying and you're hearing them, but I don't seem to get things going through. But today I want to tell you something. If you find yourself stuck in life, if you find yourself not progressing at the rate or the speed that you thought you ought to be progressing or that you hoped you would, to tell you this today, God has not forgotten you. That God remembers you. That, like God said to Moses, I remembered the covenant. I remembered the promise. And he says, now I'm going to give it to you as an inheritance, this place which I promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God has given to you a promise to take you to another level, to bring you to new heights in life, because Jesus himself said that I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. But if you haven't yet discovered that or experienced that, listen here, God has not forgotten you. Hang on. Hold on, because God has not forgotten you. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that Jesus, in Hebrews, the 7th chapter, Jesus, that God is able to save to the uttermost through Christ. Why? Because Jesus continually makes intercession for you. In the book of 1 John refers to Jesus as our advocate. The book of Romans, in the 8th chapter, Paul talks about the Holy Spirit groaning and interceding for you. You see, right now, at this very moment, you have a representative in heaven on the side of God on your behalf making intercession for you, standing in the gap for you. So God has not forgotten you. It just may not yet be your time, but trust and hold on, because your time is coming, because God wants to take you to the other side. He wants to take you to a higher level. So God tells Moses to tell his children that. Well, they don't believe. So Moses goes back, has another conversation with God. God says, okay, here's the deal. I'm going to give you signs, wonders, and miracles. So God gives Moses signs, wonders, and miracles. And now all of a sudden, you know the story. Moses goes to Pharaoh. And Moses takes God's message to Pharaoh in the old Charlton Heston movie, right? Let my people go. A terrible Charlton Heston, right? Like the song, let my people go. But of course, Pharaoh's not going to give up on his free labor program, right? I mean, he's building his pyramids. He's building his temples. He's building his altars. He's building all these great things. And Egypt is a world power. And Pharaoh's like, why would I start paying Egyptians to do it when I can get Hebrews to do it for free and with less materials? So Pharaoh says, no way. So as you know, the story goes, the 10 plagues come and God begins to work on Egypt, and God begins to show his might, and he begins to show, and he's in the process of breaking Pharaoh down. Finally, as you know, the 10th plague, the firstborn, when the spirit of death comes through and takes the firstborn, except those who had marked the lamb's blood over their doorway as a sanctified home, that spirit would pass over that. The spirit of death took the firstborn of Pharaoh, and at that point, Pharaoh's heart was broken, his spirit was broken, and Pharaoh finally conceded to let the Hebrews go. So Pharaoh gives them the permission to leave, and the Bible tells us, man, they left, and they left rich. They left taken. I mean, they literally pillaged Egypt. I mean, if you think about it, it's kind of an insensitive thing. Everybody's mourning the loss of their firstborn. Nobody's watching their gold and their jewels. So the Israelites, hey man, we got this. We got 400 years of savings saved up, and they take everything. They take all their supplies, and they go, and they leave. And as you know the story, they find themselves there at the Red Sea. At the Red Sea. Now, the lake that Pastor Dan and I had to walk around was a big lake. But the Red Sea is like so much bigger than that, that you can't just walk around it. As a matter of fact, the Bible even tells us in the book of Exodus, I think it's in the 13th chapter, that God purposely took them the wilderness route because he saw their hearts. And he knew that if they saw the wars, that they saw the fighting, that they would just turn back and go to Egypt. He knew his people. So there they find themselves at the Red Sea, and Pharaoh's heart changes. Pharaoh begins to get bitter towards the Israelites and towards Moses, and he says, you know what, I'm going to go after them, and we're going to take them back, and we're going to pick this thing back up. And so Pharaoh mounts up an army of his best chariots, of his best soldiers, and now they're coming. The children of Israel, the Hebrews, they're stuck there at the shore of the Red Sea. The only way to get to the other side is, of course, to go across. But how do you get, the Bible says, more than 600,000 men plus women and children across the Red Sea? It's a pretty big feat. So here they are, against all odds, against the Red Sea, literally a rock and a hard place. They've got the ocean on one side, and they've got Pharaoh and his army on the other side coming at them. And if you got your Bibles, now go with me to the book of Exodus, a couple pages over in Exodus, the 14th chapter. Exodus chapter 14. Here they find themselves between that rock and a hard place. In verse number 10, it says, "And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were afraid. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, 'Because there were no graves in Egypt, you have led us away to die in the wilderness. Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we might serve the Egyptians?'" They just straight out pulled up. "We told you so, Moses. You came and said, God said all these things, and we said, no, we didn't. We told you so." And that was the whole Christian Bale, kind of confused. You know, God, is he a child talking to the children of Israel? No, God spoke to Moses. And so they say, "Moses, we told you." Moses says, it's verse number 13, he says to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still." I love that. "Don't run. See the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians who you see today, you shall see no more forever." That's pretty cool. "The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." And then the Lord, I love this. Then the Lord says to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Moses, why are you crying to me? Why are you coming to me? Moses, tell the children of Israel to go forward." Wait a minute. There's a sea right there. God, I'm not quite sure your GPS coordinates got us to the right place. I've seen the articles where people drove into a lake. You know, God did it. God says, tell the children of Israel to go forward. And he tells Moses, "Moses, reach out your hand. Reach out your staff." And so there's a story goes that Moses reached out his staff. You know, you've seen the movie. Moses is all doubtful, like, "I got a staff." No, God says, "Moses, reach out your staff." The Bible says a great eastern wind came and it split the sea in half. And all of the children of Israel began to walk across the Red Sea, the Bible says, on dry ground. Of course, because it's God, the only way to get to the other side is to go across the ocean. But God is capable of doing that. And it's because it's God, God takes Pharaoh's army and he holds them up in a whirlwind and he takes all the wheels off the chariot so that the people have time to get across the Red Sea. And it's just in the right amount of time when the people cross the Red Sea that Pharaoh and his army are coming through and they're going on the dry ground of the wet sea, and all of a sudden the winds that held the sea back stop. And God drops the Red Sea on top of Pharaoh's army, completely eliminating and fulfilling exactly what he said. He said, "The army that you see, you will see no more forever." Why? Because they are at the bottom of the ocean. Yeah. You see, so much can happen. So often we think, you know what, God? I feel like you've forgotten me. God, I feel like there's just nothing there. But God, hey, he's not forgotten you. And here we see that God tells his children, he says, "Moses, why are you crying to me? Tell the children of Israel to move forward." Church, you got to move on. You got to move forward. You got to keep pressing on. Why? Because it's so easy to quit when you face hardships. The easiest thing to do when you face a hardship, when something's coming up against you, when an opposition, listen, the devil wants to rob you of who you are. The devil is envious of you, and he's going to do everything in his power to take away what God has given to you. God wants to take you to the other side. The devil wants to drag you down. And so he's not going to do so without a fight. And so when you find that opposition, one of the easiest things to do in opposition is just to give up. But God says to his people, hey, tell them to press on. Tell them to keep pressing on. You go forward. God, there's an ocean in front of me. You go forward. God has not forgotten you. on taking you to the other side. And God says, you keep pressing on. Keep fighting. Keep going. Romans in the 8th chapter, verse number 31. I love Paul says. Paul says, if God be for us, who could be against us? Church, you've got Jesus Christ on your side. You might have all of the world coming up against you, but it does not pale in comparison to Jesus Christ, who is on your side, who says, I am here to take you to another level, to take you to the other side where the grass is greener. That's my plan for you. So, of course, you know the story that the seed drops on the children of Israel, and it's all done, right? No. Because when God takes you to the other side, he took them to the other side of the Red Sea. God says, I'm not done with you. I'm going to take you to the other side again and again and again and again. It's a continual progression of God leading you to the places that he wants to take you. So there he was. God provided for them miraculously water. God provided for them miraculously food. I mean, you think about it for a moment. God gave them their law. He gave him the ordinances. He gave him the tabernacle. He gave him all the directions. And then above all of that, God says, I'm going to lead you just so that you know I'm God. I'm going to lead you in a cloud by day. Where the tabernacle was, where the Ark of the Covenant was, the Bible says that God sat there in a cloud. And at night when God wanted to move, a pillar of fire appeared and they walk to the pillar of fire. There is no mistaking. God was taking them to the other side. And so as the story progresses, as God gave them all these different things, they finally arrive at their destination and they see the promised land. The land, the Bible says, that is flowing with milk and honey. And I think God, he knew exactly what he was doing, because the Bible tells us that God brought them at the peak season of harvest. He didn't bring them in the dead of winter when all the leaves were off the trees. God brought them when everything was at its best. And so there they are at the promised land, and there they are, and the Bible tells us that they sent 12 spies into the promised land. They said, you guys need to go, and you need to scope out this land. You need to check it out. I want you to report. Is this everything? Is this the place that God is telling us to go? And so there, the 12 spies spend 40 days in the promised land. The Bible even tells us that the land was so fruitful that they found grapes. Now remember, it was the harvest season, so God knew exactly what he's doing. They found grapes, and the Bible says one cluster of grapes they cut, and they had to carry it between two guys. Now you go to Stater Brothers or Albertsons or Trader Joe's, and you buy a cluster of grapes, and it's like this big. So think about that for a moment. A cluster of grapes that you got to carry between two guys. Like, babe, come over here. This cluster of grapes on sale, and we got to take this home. And you're like, huffing it over your shoulder. That's how it was. As a matter of fact, I think I know what they saw, because geographically speaking, Israel is the same landscape as California. The land flowing of milk and honey. If any of you came from another state in the United States, particularly one that right now was buried under snow, you know California, amen, is the promised land. The land filled flowing with milk and honey, where you can see snow from a distance. So they came and they saw all the fruitfulness of the land, and they come back and they reported everything to Moses and everything to the children of Israel. Now, if you got your Bibles, go with me, because we'll skip now to the book of Numbers. Now, go with me to Numbers a couple books over. Numbers in the 13th chapter. Let's read what they begin to say. Numbers chapter 13. So they're given the report. They see that this is a land flowing with milk and honey. This is the land. This is the place. This is it. They have arrived. And so here in Numbers, the 13th chapter, verse number 26, says, now they departed from spying, and they came back to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. And they brought back word to them and to all the congregation, and they showed them the fruit of the land. They were like, look at these grapes. For us Californians, we'd be like, look at these avocados, guacamole. They showed them the... And then they told them, they said, man, we went to the land that you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit. But look at verse number 28. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Verse number 29 goes on. Do we have verse number 29? And the Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains, the Canaanites dwell by the sea along the banks of the Jordan. They're saying this land already has people in it. This is the promised land. There's already people here. Don't you know, isn't that just kind of the way it goes? When everything starts to happen for you, when everything starts to progress and you're saying, you know what, I'm on my way. You know what, okay, I've gotten over all these little vices and I'm finally moving. I feel the Spirit of God leading me like oceans, the song says, lead me. And all of a sudden you hit a road bump. All of a sudden you trip and fall. All of a sudden something happens in your life and you've got a problem on the way to the other side. Listen, here's the thing. Because of this report, because of those words, nevertheless, they gave them a bad report. The children of Israel decided not to go into the promised land. Church, God wants to take you to the other side. God has not forgotten about you in that journey. Keep pressing forward and don't be afraid of the giants along the way, because there's going to be hardships. There's going to be trials. There's going to be battles. There's going to be fights. There's going to be times of stretching and times of growing in your life that might even be painful. But God says, don't be afraid of the giants along the way, because I am with you. Think about it for a moment. The children of Israel didn't do anything to get out of Egypt. God put 10 plagues on Pharaoh and his people. God drowned the army. God had given them a victory in the wilderness. God had fed them every day of their life in the wilderness. God had supplied every need. God had done everything, and now all of a sudden, all of that goes out the window, and they forget. You think God might be a little bit upset about that? Yeah, I think so. So we know the story, as the story goes, that they decide not to go into the promised land. So God says, Moses, this generation, I'm done. I'm over it. I'm tired of your griping. I'm tired of your whining. Moses, take them back into the desert. So there we know the story goes that they were led by God into the wilderness for 40 years. 40 years, because they were afraid of the giants in their journey. Church, don't be afraid of the fight. Don't be afraid of the battle. Don't be afraid of what's ahead of you. Why? Because there might always be a giant in front of your promise, but Jesus Christ is always bigger than your giants. I mean, think about the giant that Jesus sent his disciples on as he was going to heaven, as he was ascending to heaven. In Matthew, the 28th chapter, verse number 19, Jesus says, now go. Go into all the world and make disciples. Can you guys put the Great Commission up for me? Don't have it? Right on. Oh, there you go. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Look what verse number 20 says. Jesus says, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Why? And lo, I am with you always, even until the ends of the earth. You might be facing a giant, but that giant's going to run from you. Why? Because you got Jesus standing behind you. Just like David. To that battle, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that defies the armies of the living God? Is there not a cause, he says. Church, God wants to take you to the other side. He wants to take you to a new place. And there's going to be giants in that journey, but don't fear the giants along the way, because they turned back and they paid the price. 40 years they wandered in the wilderness. And so 40 years they wander in the wilderness until the time comes. And God says, Moses, it's time. Think about it. Moses is 120 years old. God says, Moses, it's done. Hand it over. So Moses passes the baton to Joshua. He tells Joshua, Joshua, it's your turn. It's time. God wants us to go into the promised land. If you got your Bibles, we'll conclude looking at this little statement in Deuteronomy, the 31st chapter. Deuteronomy chapter 31. God tells Moses to tell Joshua these things. And as Joshua is taking the leadership of the children of Israel, Moses says to Joshua in Deuteronomy chapter 31, look at this, verse number 7. Moses says to Joshua in the sight of Israel, be strong and of good courage. Pastor David was talking about this earlier. For you must go with this people to the land which the Lord has sworn to their fathers to give them. And you shall cause them to inherit it. And look what he says. And the Lord, he is the one who goes before you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be dismayed. Moses tells Joshua, Joshua, inherit the land. But Joshua, understand this. God goes before you. So often what happens in life, we try to do things our way. God, I'm not getting to that other side. God, I'm not getting to that other place. God, I'm not getting to where I want to be, and I want to be there yesterday, so I'm going to start doing things my way. You know, right after the children of Israel decided to not go into the promised land the first time, they realized their mistake and they tried to enter the promised land. But the Bible says that the Ark of the Covenant and God was not with them and they were driven out of that area. But now Moses tells Joshua, God goes before you. Church, God wants to take you to the other side. But let God lead you to the other side. Let God lead you to the other side. Don't try to do it your way. Don't try to get to the other side on your power. Don't try to make it happen in your timing. Let God lead you to the other side. Why? Because God wants to take you to the other side. God has not forgotten you in this journey. Keep pressing forward. Keep moving on. Even when you don't think you can, keep fighting the good fight of faith like Paul tells Timothy. Why? Because you don't have to fear the giants along the way, because God wants to take you to the other side and God goes before you. In Joshua, the third chapter, Joshua commands the priests as they're about to cross into the promised land for the very first time in their lives. They're crossing the Jordan River. Once again, God has brought them to the season, the peak season. The Jordan River has swollen. The river is twice its normal size. And this is not like a little river. You know, whenever it rains in California, there's always that one guy that gets stuck in like the drainage ditch, and it's always all over the news, right? Crossing the Jordan River would be like that, times a million people, okay? So God says to Joshua, I go before you. Joshua commands the priest. He says, priest, I want you to grab the Ark of the Covenant, and I want you to go in front of everybody. You see, the Ark of the Covenant always represented God's promises and God's presence. Joshua said, I want to put God's promises and I want to put God's presence first to enter the promised land. And sure enough, as the Ark of the Covenant goes forward, as the priests that are carrying that ark step into the Jordan River, as their feet begin to get wet, all of a sudden, boom, the waters of the Jordan River split. And once again, 40 years later, God takes the children of Israel to the other side. This time to their promised land, because they put God first. Jesus says in John, the 10th chapter, verse number 27, Jesus says, I am the great shepherd. My sheep hear my voice and I know them. Look what he says, and they follow me. So many times in my own life, I know that I'm this way. I'm trying to get ahead of God. God, I want to move at my own pace. I got dogs. Anybody have dogs? Anybody have dogs in this place? I got big dogs. Well, they're kind of medium-sized dogs, but they're fat, so they're big dogs. My dogs like to roll with me, and they know that I'm the alpha male of the house, but they always are walking in front of me. Wherever we're going, I just love watching them. I try to do it to them. They're walking, and we're walking, and wherever they're going, they're walking, and they're walking like this. Like, I'm in front. I'm in front, but what are you doing? I'm in front. And I just love it when they're walking, and I can see right up ahead there's like a mailbox or a doorpost, or whatever it might be, and they're just walking, they're looking at you like, I'm ahead of you, boom, and they run into it. So many times we try to do that. We're saying, God, I want you to take me, I want you to take me to the other side. God, you're taking me. God, you're taking me, right? God, you're taking, and we're not even looking where we're going. Instead, church, let God lead you to the other side. Our vision, our desire, our whole process in life should be to see the back of God as we walk into the promised land, because God is leading you to the other side. Church, there are those of you in this place that God spoke something to you. God said something to you. Maybe you're believing in God for your healing. Maybe you're believing in God for your job. Maybe you're believing in God for your children or your family. I don't know what it is. You know where God wants to take you, but God wants to take you to the other side. And when things aren't happening, it's really easy to begin to think, God forgot about me again. But listen, as you walk out of this place today, know God did not forget you. Know this, that there's going to be fights, there's going to be hardships, there's going to be challenges at every direction, but God says, why are you crying to me, Moses? Tell my children to keep pressing forward. Don't give up. Don't lose hope. Hold on. I think it was Theodore Roosevelt that said, when you get to the bottom of your rope, hold on, because God is coming. God is going to take you to the other side. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of the giants on your way, because they'll be there. But you've got Jesus. He says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I am with you to the ends of the age. And Matthew ends at the end of that. Amen. And John says, God, Jesus is the shepherd, and we hear his voice, and we follow him. As God takes you to the other side, let God take you to the other side. Follow God to the other side. And I promise, church, it'll be the ride of your life, but it will be worth it. It will be worth it. Did somebody get something out of that today? Amen. Amen. Well, God is good. There's some of you in this place today, and I'm going to let you out. I'm going to try to get this done in just a couple of minutes. I want to keep you longer than we need to, but I want to just do me a favor, give me a moment more of your attention. I promise we'll let you out in just a minute or two. There are some of you in this place today that if you're looking at your life and you're looking at your heart, you're looking at where you are with God, maybe you haven't yet started on that journey. I'm here to tell you today, God wants to take you to the other side. Don't let that little pre-fire alarm distract you. Listen to what I got to say. They'll fix that. God wants to take you to the other side. Maybe you haven't yet started that journey. Maybe you're looking at your life and you're beginning to realize, you know what, there's a lot of emptiness on the inside of me. There's just something going on. There's storms on the inside, and I need something to happen in my life. God wants to take you to the other side. Now, if you look at your life and you say, you know what, maybe I'm just not there. Maybe I don't stand in the right place, or I don't stand in the right position with God. Today, I want to give you the opportunity. Because, you know, there's so many things, and there's so many pretense, and there's so many thoughts that we have that we think that everything's good between us and God, and that I'm poised and I'm positioned for God to take me to the other side, when in reality, we are separated by God from our sins. And so often what happens is we think, you know what, if I'm a good person, we think that if I'm a spiritual person, that I have an awareness to the spirituality of things around me. We begin to think, you know what, I'm a religious person. My parents brought me up in church, and I've always given myself a title of Christian. We begin to think things like, well, you know what, I attend church, and I always thought because I went to church, that means that God's going to take me to the other side, because in a church service, the pastor said, God's going to take me to the other side. But the truth of the matter is that the only way for you and I to be connected to God, to be in that right position, to be in that right standing for God, to be poised for God to do something in our lives, is the acceptance of Jesus Christ. You see, so often what happens in our society is we like to think things like, well, you know what, you believe what you believe, and I'll believe what I'll believe, and we're all good together. You know, we'll all get there somehow, some way, together. But you know what? Unfortunately, that's not what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one goes to the Father except through him. You see, Jesus Christ is the only way for you and I to position ourselves with God, to where sin is no longer the issue between us and God, because Jesus Christ, the Bible says, took our sins upon him so that we could become the righteousness of God through him. It's a gift. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And today, maybe you're in this place today, and you haven't yet accepted that gift. Maybe you thought through a course of tradition, or through a course of ritual, or ceremony, or religion, that everything's good. But today, if you look at your heart, you look at your life, you say, you know what, Pastor Luke, on the inside of me, I feel like I've never had that. I've never had that connection. I've never had that acceptance of Jesus in my life. And today, I want to go where God wants to take me. I want to go to a new level. I want to go to the other side of life. I know God's got things in store for me, but I need to do something about that. Today, I want to give you the opportunity to accept that gift. You see, you don't accept that gift, or it doesn't come because you're a good person. You know, there's a lot of people out there doing a lot of great things, but the Bible tells us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, is like filthy rags. Nothing we could ever do would make us good enough in God's standards. Why? Because sin separates us. But because of Jesus Christ, Jesus comes and he became sin. He came and died on a cross and became sin for you and for me. So now that God, when he looks at us, he sees Jesus as our covering. And that comes because you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and as your Savior. In the book of John, in the third chapter, the same chapter, the same reference, the same scripture reference where we get John 3:16, the most famous scripture of all. Jesus is speaking to a religious leader, and he says, in order to see the kingdom of God, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must, he says, be born again. Born again is not what Hollywood's made it out to be, what the internet or what culture or society's made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, God didn't send Jesus to die on a cross to be sin in your place so that you would have a casual following of him. A token prayer here and again. occasional church attendance. God sent Jesus Christ that you would give all of your life to him and in return accept and receive life from Jesus Christ. It was an even exchange, the great exchange. In the book of Revelation, Jesus Christ is speaking to his church and he says, listen, I'm gonna return. And when I come, I'd rather find that you're hot. He says, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you, I'll reject you. I'll expel you from the kingdom of God. Church, don't let that be you. That's a shocking statement. And Jesus was saying that to a church, to believers. Why? To get their attention, to say, stop doing things your way. Your ways are not my ways. Your thoughts are not my thoughts, God says. My ways are higher. My thoughts are higher. And I want to take you to that place. But God says, you've got to come to me. Today I want to give you that opportunity. The gift of eternal salvation is through Jesus Christ. And like any gift, you have the choice to accept it or to reject it. To take it or to leave it, so to say. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way in. Today, you have the free will choice. The decision right now is the Spirit of God, I believe, is speaking to you to decide to choose life in Jesus Christ. Jesus said these words that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He says that if you deny him, he'll deny you before his Father. I'm going to give you the opportunity. I want to do it this way. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying today, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I want to give all of my life to Jesus Christ. I want to surrender that over. I want to hand that over to God because I want God to take me to where God wants me to go. The Spirit of God, I believe, is speaking to you right now. The Bible says that no one can come to the Father unless the Spirit draws him. And I believe that the Spirit of God is speaking to you. There are many of you in this place that maybe there's an emptiness on the inside of you that you've just never been able to fill. A thirst that you've never been able to quench. Why? That's a hole on the inside of you that God's designed to fill, Jesus Christ. And today is the day of your salvation, the day in which everything changes, the day in which God is going to take you to the other side of life. To take you to that greater place, to take you to that higher level. But it starts by making a decision. What you're doing by the raising of your hand before everybody around you, you're making a decision before humanity, before people in a public place. You're saying, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God your life. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm not here to point you out. I'm here to build you up and to help you through life, through Jesus Christ. This is the very best thing you can do. If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, in just a moment, if that's you, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group once before, but you're not really sure when you walk out of this place, you say, I just don't know where I stand. Listen, don't walk out of this place without knowing where you stand. Why? Because you have the right today to know where you stand with God, and that's right standing with God through Jesus Christ by accepting his Son. If you've been living lukewarm, what does that mean, lukewarm? It means that you're doing your own thing. You're doing a little bit of your thing, doing a little bit of the church thing. You're kind of in, you're kind of out. You're not hot, you're not cold, you're nothing. Jesus says, if that's you, you're deceived in thinking you're going to make it into the kingdom of God. Don't let that be you. Don't get caught up in the trap of complacency in Christianity, because that's the best place that the devil can keep you in. Just enough to think that you're okay, but really enough to not make it all the way. Today, that doesn't have to be you. Today is a day of your salvation. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. I believe tonight you're here for a divine appointment between you and God to accept life, to accept God, to accept Jesus into your heart and into your life, and to watch everything begin to change as God takes you to the other side. Wherever you're at in this place, all across this auditorium, from side to side, front row to back row, even you guys in the family rooms, I'll see you through the windows. Maybe you're outside watching by a closed circuit television, or you're on the live stream right now watching. If that's you in this place today, or if you're on the live stream, you can minimize the viewer, get back to the main viewer page, and there's a little blue button that you can press on. It says, "Know God." Somebody will pray with you right there. But today, for you in this place, this is your moment. This is your time to accept life through Jesus Christ. The Spirit of God speaking to you, and now it's time for you to respond. All across this auditorium, all over this place, wherever you're at. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. And we're going to go to the other side together with Jesus Christ. Tonight, your destiny's going to change right here, right now. I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you in this place, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Here we go. One, two,
3.
Let me see your hands in this place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I see that hand. 6, 7, 8. I see you guys. 9. I got you back over there. 9 wise people over in here. 10. I see you right over there. 10 wise people over here. I got you right over here. 11. 11 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? 11 wise people. I didn't see if you give me a wave. 12. I got you back there. 13. I see you there, my friend. 13 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? 13 wise people. Everybody likes to scratch their heads right at this time. You make it real hard. If you got an itch, wait. 13 wise people. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Where are you at, number 13? Give me a wave so I can see you. Where are you at? I see the ushers pointing at you. I see you there in the family room, number 13. Number 14, where are you at? I say, man, I wonder if I should. Yep, in the family room right over there, 14. 1 or 2? 1. I thought it's so 1, 13 wise people. All right. 14. Where are you at, number 15? Come on. I feel you in this place. I got you right there. All right, number 15. Where are you at, number 16? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on. Spirit of God speaking to you. Anybody else in this place that I'm going to close it down? 15 wise people. I didn't embarrass them. I didn't embarrass you. I won't embarrass you. It's your moment, your time. Anybody else today? 15 wise people. Well, let's praise God for 15 wise people. Number 16, I got you right there, sister. 16 wise people. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to conclude tonight. All 16 of you, maybe number 17, you didn't raise your hand, or 17, you didn't, I didn't see it, 18, 19, hey, you know what, let's just go for broke, number 19, number 20, you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have. The Spirit of God speaking to you, saying, man, this is me, God's calling me. You don't get saved by raising your hand, you're making the decision, you're deciding, I'm going to follow Jesus, that's what we talked about. Every decision requires action, and we're going to do that together. We're going to change destinies together. I said that. We're going to go together to the other side, and I want you to do that. I want to do that with you today. So if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get out of your seat, get into the aisle, come up and meet me right here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together. We're all going to stand as we do. Pastor David's going to sing a song. If that's you in this place, come on, come meet me right here. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. This is your moment.
God, miracles come. We need,
if that's you, you come. Come on.
Supernatural love to break.
Amen. Come on, that's you.
Nothing's impossible for the God of
wherever you're at, if that's you, you're making that decision. Come on, this is your moment. This is your time. Well, hey guys, so cool you came. And I just want to congratulate you, because you're starting a journey God's going to take you to the other side. God's going to take you to new places. Hey, he didn't forget you. You're here today. Keep on pressing on, right? Don't be afraid of the giants that are on your way. You know what? There's going to be giants in your life. That's all right. You've got Jesus coming up. And let God lead you. That's what you're doing today. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple of things. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. You heard me talking about all the words that I'm not supposed to say. Privileged, honor. I don't remember what they were. Somebody's got to, baby, you got to help me with these words when we go home. I'm as weird as it gets, all right? You made it through me. You survived, okay? He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to do a couple things. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you're inviting, asking God to come into your heart, to come into your life. You're proclaiming that God is now, Jesus is now that Lord and Savior of your life, and everything's going to change in that moment. He's going to give you some free information, because you walk out of this place, you're going to say, what do I do on my journey? I want to go to the other side. That we got some information, some literature that's going to say, you know what? This is what's going to happen in your life, and this is the things that you need to do, start doing in your life. Third thing he wants to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to come back, okay? To get connected with us, to hang out. We want to connect you with a friend here at church. Somebody that will meet with you in our cafe. They'll buy you a cup of coffee or get you a soda, sit down with you for a couple of weeks, for just a little while before church, to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God, so that you don't go back to the way that to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Amen.